A fluid and solid body rotation generates a parabolic surface. This has important practical application because it's a lot cheaper to take liquid and spin it in a circle to generate a parabolic surface than it is to mold or form or machine a parabolic surface. This flow is also illustrative of Euler's equations of motion in streamline coordinates, which are among the most important equations in all of fluid mechanics. This tank is filled with water, and it's mounted with a camera. It's rectangular because that makes it easier to see the shape of the interface. And it's mounted on a motor so that we can spin the fluid in solid body rotation. If we take this surface and we start it spinning, we'll see that the shape of the surface changes. You can see that the shape of this has changed, both in the stationary and in the reference frame. And the exact shape that we've generated, which is a parabola, is illustrative of Euler's inviscid equations of motion. Most mechanical engineering flows are high Reynolds number flows, which means that an inviscid analysis is often a very good approximation of the flow, at least in most of the domains of the flow. When the Reynolds number is high, this inviscid analysis typically gives us very good insight about the general properties of the flow, even when we have to add some sort of viscous correction afterwards. This rotating tank is actually an extraordinary example, because as long as this rotation is aligned perfectly with the z-axis, this flow is actually completely inviscid, and we can use Euler's inviscid equations of motion to completely describe this flow. Let's consider a steady flow, like this steadily rotating tank. We can write Euler's equations of motions in a fixed coordinate frame. This is what we would call an Eulerian approach, where we focus on points in space and control surfaces and control volumes, rather than focusing on masses or systems. But what we find is we actually get more insight more quickly if we use a Lagrangian approach. And instead of focusing on points in space, we focus on an individual fluid particle and how it moves in space and time. Streamline coordinate systems are cylindrical coordinates that, rather than being fixed in space, are tied to the fluid as it moves through space. We have three different coordinate directions. One, which moves in the direction in which the fluid is moving. One, which moves in the direction toward which the fluid's velocity is rotating. And a third direction, which points in a direction where the fluid is neither moving nor accelerating. The names we use for these coordinate systems are used to describe their relation to the streamlines of a flow. For a fluid moving on a streamline that's curving in a specific direction, we define the streamwise coordinate in the direction of the streamline, the normal coordinate in the direction in which that streamline is curving, and the binormal coordinate in the direction that's normal to both the direction of the fluid and the direction in which that fluid streamline is curving. In a certain sense, this might seem unnecessarily complicated. We've defined a different coordinate system for every point in space that's associated with the streamlines and how the streamlines are curving. But it turns out that this ends up being much easier. Because these streamlines are aligned with the fluid's velocity and affected by the fluid's acceleration, these streamline coordinates are actually much more closely tied to the fluid physics, and they lead to considerable simplifications when we look at the governing equations. With a streamline coordinate system comes enormous simplifications. Specifically, we get information about the Bernoulli constant and the hydrostatic constant and how they change in different directions. If we follow a streamline in the streamwise direction, we know that the Bernoulli constant doesn't change along that path. If we look at the normal direction, the direction in which the streamline is curving, we know that there must be some gradient in the hydrostatic constant that generates a force that causes that acceleration. And that gradient has to be proportional both to the speed squared and inversely proportional to the radius of curvature of the streamline. Finally, if we look in the binormal direction, this is a direction in which there's no motion and there's no acceleration, and therefore there can't be any force. And so we know that in the binormal direction, the hydrostatic constant has to be uniform. So what this means is that if we know the streamlines, if we know the path that the fluid takes through a fluid flow, that means we know what's happening to the Bernoulli constant and the hydrostatic constant, and that means we know what the pressure distribution is in the system. And this helps us understand a bunch of things. It helps us understand, for example, how the shape of an airfoil leads to curvature of streamlines and therefore lift. It also helps us understand, for example, for flow through a venturi, how as the venturi necks down into the throat, how that generates a pressure change that can be used to mix fuel and air or can be used to measure the flow rate in that sort of system. And it also helps us understand that if we take fluid and we rotate it in a circle, we make a parabolic shape. This parabolic shape is useful to us for manufacturing, in particular, large parabolic things. If you look at this example of a rotating system that's used to generate the lenses for the Giant Magellan Telescope, you can see that the rotation is used to more inexpensively create something with a very complex mathematical shape. Why are Euler's equations and streamlines coordinates cool for this sort of application? Well, the relation between the streamlines and their orientation and the governing equations are relatively simple. And in particular for this flow, the relation between the geometry and the streamline coordinates is simple, because this is the special case where all of the streamline coordinates are actually uniform everywhere in the flow. Everywhere in this flow, the fluid is moving in the azimuthal direction in the xy plane. Everywhere in this flow, the streamlines are curving towards the center x-axis on which this is rotating. And everywhere in the flow, if we look vertically up and down, there's no motion and no acceleration in that direction. So, fluid rotating as a solid body is probably the easiest implementation of these streamline coordinates. But we'll actually be able to implement these streamline coordinates and the physical understanding that comes from them in a variety of flows that are much more complicated. For the rotating tank, the Euler equation in streamline coordinates says that the Bernoulli constant doesn't change as it moves azimuthally along a streamline. And that means that the velocity and pressure and height of the system are all axially symmetric. The Euler equation in the normal direction tells us that because this fluid is accelerating centripetally, there has to be a variation of the pressure as we move radially. And we can show that that pressure is parabolic. That change in the pressure leads to a net force that causes the acceleration that keeps the fluid in this circular orbit. Finally, the Euler equation in the binormal direction tells us that the hydrostatic constant is uniform in the binormal direction. And for this flow, what that tells us is that the same hydrostatic equation that told us how pressure varied with elevation in a static flow actually still applies here. And the reason for that is that because both the velocity and the acceleration are exclusively in the xy plane. So for this system, we know that the pressure on the surface is atmospheric. And because the pressure on the surface is atmospheric, we can then show that the height of the water in this system varies radially, parabolically, just as the pressure does. We can also show that this is not a function of any fluid properties. So it's not a function of density, and it's not a function of viscosity. It's not a function of viscosity because there are no viscous effects in this flow at all. And it's not a function of the density because the density effects cancel out, both from the binormal equation, the hydrostatic equation, and from the normal equation, the acceleration term. In the end, then, we get an expression for the height as a function of radius that's parabolic and varies only as a function of the rotation rate, the size of the system, and the gravitational acceleration. So we can ask ourselves, is the shape of this interface a function of the amount of water? And we find that it is, in the sense that if we add more water, this parabolic shape will just rise. If we took water away, the parabolic shape would just lower. We also might ask, well, is this a function of the shape of the bottom of the tank? This tank has a flat bottom. What if I made the bottom of the tank curved? Would that increase the angle here? Or what if I put a bottom that was bowed the other direction? Would that cancel this out? And the answer is no, it wouldn't, in the same way that you can dunk something in the bottom of your bathtub and the top is always going to be level. The shape of your bathtub doesn't affect the top because the top is an isobar of the equilibrium solution of that fluid in the system. What's happening here is that because we've created acceleration, now the isobars themselves are all parabolic rather than being flat. And that's independent of anything that we put inside this tank or the shape of the bottom or the sides. Okay, now let's assume that I take some Alka-Seltzer and I put the Alka-Seltzer tablet in this tank. Let's see what happens. Well, Alka-Seltzer is a combination of aspirin and citric acid and sodium bicarbonate. And so that forms a reaction that releases carbon dioxide. And you can see these bubbles leaving the Alka-Seltzer tablet and moving vertically in the system. In a static tank, if I add Alka-Seltzer,
plop, plop, fizz, fizz, oh, what a relief it is.
The bubbles that are generated will move straight up. Because these bubbles are small, their motion is quasi-steady state, and so they move up normal to the isobars in the system, which for the static tank are horizontal lines. So I can change this system by causing it to rotate. Now, when I cause it to rotate, how will these bubbles act? Will the bubbles still move straight up? Or will they move to the side? Or will they move at an angle? And will they follow a path that's straight? Or will that path be curved? So think about that for a couple seconds while I play a video of a baby rhino having its head scratched by a zookeeper. All right, here's my Alka-Seltzer, and then we'll rotate the tank. What should be apparent is that as the bubbles leave the surface of the Alka-Seltzer tablet, they no longer move straight up. Instead, now they're moving at an angle. And in fact, the path they take is slightly curved because they're moving normal to the isobars everywhere. And the isobars, because they're parabolas, are curving slightly as we move up in this flow. Okay, now, how about if we have two fluids with two different densities? Like, say we add oil to this system. If I put oil into this system, I'll have an oil-air interface and an oil-water interface. What shapes will those two interfaces have? Think about that for a couple seconds while I play a video of a raccoon eating a grape. Okay, let's add this oil to the tank. Okay, let's give this a try. So you can see that this system has some instabilities as it comes to equilibrium. But as it comes to equilibrium, you can see a parabolic shape in the water-oil interface and a parabolic shape in the oil-air interface. Both of these interfaces exist at isobars in the system, and both of these are parabolic. In fact, they're the same parabolas, and the only thing that's different about them is that they're offset by a specific height in the z-direction. So in this case, the heights are parabolic, and the parabola for the oil-air interface and the oil-water interface are the same. But the pressure distribution now has changed. Within each domain, within the oil or within the water, the pressure varies parabolically, and it varies parabolically in a way that's proportional to the local density. So there's a parabolic dependence in the oil, and there's a parabolic dependence in the water. If we take a horizontal cut through the system that goes through both oil and water, we'll find that the pressure relation as a function of the radius is now piecewise parabolic, where it's parabolic in the center, and then it has a discontinuous change and is parabolic on the outside. And that, again, is related to the change in the density. By the same token, if we look at the pressure variation in the binormal direction, we'll find that that's piecewise linear, again, because of the changes in the density between these two systems. And remember, all of these results are directly calculable from the Euler's inviscid equations and streamline coordinates. In the streamwise direction, that tells us that the system is axially symmetric. In the normal direction, it tells us that we have pressure increasing as we move to the outside. And in the binormal direction, it tells us that the hydrostatic equation applies. Okay, what if we have three fluids? Like, let's suppose, in addition to the oil and the water, we had a fluorocarbon that's denser than water. All right, let's give this a try. Just as was the case before, there's some instability in this system, but what you see is that as the system comes to steady state, you again see the same parabolic shapes from the air-oil and the oil-water interface, and now at the bottom in the corners, you see the interface between the water and the fluorocarbon. So, Euler's equations in streamline coordinates are great. They help us understand the relation between the velocity distribution and the pressure distribution. And they're really good for this case because we know what the velocity field is and the streamline coordinates were simple. However, in some cases, we won't know what the velocity distribution is, and we don't know where the streamlines are. And in that case, Euler's equations in that form can't help us. Now, the equations we used are steady and inviscid. And that works well for this flow, because this is a steadily rotating flow. And because it's solid body rotation, there are no viscous effects. However, if we try to use these equations to apply to some viscous-dominated flow, like flow moving through a small capillary or something like that, then these equations would not be useful, and they wouldn't give us the correct answer. So, anytime a fluid is in solid body rotation, it forms a parabolic shape. Practically speaking, this helps us create objects that are parabolic in shape. And then from a theoretical point of view, this helps us understand how Euler's equations in streamline coordinates help us understand the relation between velocity and pressure in these sorts of systems.